Please be seated. And good morning. It is wonderful to be able to welcome you this morning. Everyone who gathers in this place, if this happens to be the first time that you've gathered together with us, so glad that you are, and trust that it will feel like family before very long this morning. A welcome to those joining us by live stream. Glad that you're part of the family today as well. Now, there's an invitation that I offer to you. After worship, we have the opportunity to linger a little longer over coffee and perhaps some goodies in the church hall, which is found just to this door on your left. And there you can renew some friendship and have a good time together. There is nursery available for those three and under who may need it, and you can find that, parents, through the door and down the stairs just beyond our technical desk. And Dylan and Danny are handling Sunday Club for the four and older today. I bring welcome from myself, the Reverend Philip Newman, the lead minister here at West Vancouver United Church, and from my colleague, the Reverend Simon LeSieur, and from our minister of music, Gerald van Wyck, and our amazing choir as well this morning. There are a few announcements that I point out today. You will have already seen the visual of Bibles and books that are stacked in front of the communion table. It's reminding us that today is Bible Sunday. We're focusing somewhat on that holy text that is so precious to our tradition. And after worship, there are opportunities in the church hall to take a look at some special Bibles that folks have brought for you to take a look at. Some are so fragile that you might not want to touch them, but others you can explore. And there's resources there that might help you just to dig a little deeper into the Word. We want to let you know as well that there's a couple of Bible studies that run every week, one on Monday, one on Tuesday, and you might consider being part of that opportunity to grow just a little deeper. In your bulletin today, you have a yellow sheet which it has some explanation on one side and the reverse side, and you'll see a space for your name and a favorite verse. Rather than put that on the offering plate today, feel free to fill it out and just bring it with you into the church hall, and it'll be used there. So just keep it with you once you've completed it, and we'll have some fun with that. Tomorrow, the UCW unit, the Oikumene unit, is hosting a special evening with Corey Reed, and they would really love any youth that would be there to hear about life challenges and how this person addressed them and overcame them. A couple of Sundays from now is October the 30th, and we will be celebrating All Saints. And we invite you to consider the names that you would like to be remembered as we celebrate that Sunday, the saints that have gone on before us. There will be a page at the welcome table in the church hall today after worship. You can add a name to that list. You could leave a name at the church office. You could email it in as well. Or just write it on a blank space of paper that you see in the bulletin and tear it off and put it on the offering plate. All those ways we'll get it there, and we'll have a full and complete time together. Speaking of saints, Simon and his extended family have bid farewell to Simon's Oma. She passed away on Friday evening. And she was just a wonderful matriarch, a faithful, prayerful woman that upheld Simon's family. And so we invite you just to continue to hold Simon and all their extended family in your prayers and hold them in love through these days. Jerry, you have an announcement for us this morning.
We have a concert coming up. There's a little bookmark in your bulletins reminding us of that. And many of our concerts are large-scale works. We'll be doing Messiah, for instance, at Christmas time, and Creation in the spring. This concert we've called Friends, and it explores the theme of friendship, either directly in the music, so the texts talk about the joy of friendship, or in terms of relationships, sometimes between composers and those who commission their works. There will be a work that was written for our choir that's by a friend of our choir. And so it's a wonderful kaleidoscope, really, of music and different styles. It features a mass by Dvorak and also features a variety of instrumentation. We have our magnificent church organ as the main accompaniment, but we also have a harpist amongst our midst, and also a violin will be there. And the soloists, part of our choir, will present a significant part of the program as well. So it should be a wonderful wide variety of music and of lovely songs and words and poetry on the theme of friendship. This is Sunday, November 13th at 2 p.m. Tickets are available from any one of these fine folk, or from the church office, or even in the hall after the service.
Good morning.
Good morning. As Philip mentioned, today we are we're taking a deeper look at Scripture, at the Bible, at our sacred holy texts. And the idea, there's been many people working on this over the last few weeks, but I would like to invite Liz Burney to light the Christ candle this morning for I guess the original vision and for the excitement that I guess turns out that it coincided with this actually being listed as a Bible Sunday. And so Liz was very humble in not taking any of the credit. But Liz, thank you just for your passion for prayer, for Bible study, for Scripture. And as we go deeper into worship, may you light the Christ candle as a reminder of Christ's light in this world. Please join with me in the call to worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Sing and bless God's holy name. Tell the glad news of salvation from day to day.
Let us declare God's glory among the nations, among all the peoples, God's wonderful works.
For great is God, and greatly to be praised. Let the heavens rejoice, and the earth be glad.
Let us worship God.
Oh,
we prepare to gather ourselves together in prayer, let's just breathe in. Breathe in deeply that sense of God's creative spirit that is with us even now. Let us pray. Loving God, we come to worship today because we love you and we want to love you more. We come to worship, needing love in our lives. Love for family, friends, strangers, and enemies. In this gathering of worship, touch our hearts with your word. The word that shouts from pages of holy texts, and the word whispered by your spirit. Fill us with the love revealed in the gospel stories, the
to invite the children and teens present to come up to the front before we head off to Sunday Club. How's everyone doing this morning? Me? You survived the storm? James? I heard you guys lost power. Did anyone else lose power last night? Or this week, I guess? No? James, it was just you. But you made it, which is great. Yes, Emma? Whoa, so last year Emma's friend lost power for 3 days. Whoa, that must have been scary. So today's Bible Sunday, right? And last week we talked a little bit, I asked the older group if you had some favorite Bible characters. And a lot of you seem to really love Moses. I don't know why, but his name kept coming up. But I would love to know, does anyone have a favorite Bible story? Question, eh? Yeah, Poppy?
Well, I came as Noah's Ark.
Here, do you want to say it to hear?
Well, I came as Noah's Ark.
You came as Noah's Ark? Do you want to show us what you brought? Here, can I stand up with it so everyone can see? So Poppy came with Noah's Ark. So we've got, is this Bambi? And there's the dragon. So there's only one dragon in Noah's Ark, which is probably why they don't exist anymore. Oh, nice, a Pokemon. That's awesome. Oh, two of them. Great. Well, we're all set. That's great. So would you say Poppy Noah's Ark is one of your favorite Bible stories? That's great. What about you, Emma?
Mother Teresa.
Oh, Mother Teresa is one of your favorite saints. What do you like about Mother Teresa?
Well, she was a nice lady and she helped other people.
Yeah, that's true. And that's a lot of what Jesus invites us to do, right? Is to love people and to take care of them. So before you head off to Sunday Club, I'll say a quick prayer, and you guys will be talking a lot about the Bible today. And I know there's several of you who are lined up for the confirmation class that starts today. And so those of you who are in grade 8 and above who are doing confirmation will be meeting at 12 in the youth room. All right, but before we do that, let me just pray for all of you, and I hope you have a great time with Dylan and Danny this morning. All right, let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. God, that your word that's alive and that calls us to action, and that calls us to love. God, as we head off to Sunday Club, God, may you continue to teach us, God, about this holy, beautiful book. We pray all of this in Jesus' awesome and holy name. Amen. All right, so off we go.
Let us pray. Gracious, merciful, and forgiving God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Today is Bible Sunday, and we are full of grateful praise for your holy word that reveals to us your righteousness, your trustworthiness, your truthfulness, your faithfulness, your unchangeable eternal presence, your light, your purity, and your steadfast love for us. We praise you for your righteous commandments taught to us by Jesus. They show us how to follow the right and avoid the wrong way to think, speak, and act. Lord, we ask that you accept our praise. When we wander away from you and into other ways again and again, like lost sheep, we ask that you find us and bring us back. Your scriptures give us the information and guidelines we need to determine your will, but we need your help and the guidance of your Holy Spirit to follow it and to provide the strength and wisdom to act and think according to your will. We also depend on your grace for the strength and wisdom contemplating your sacred word gives us to withstand the pressures and temptations we encounter. Your divine revelation tells us what you expect from us and what we may expect from you. We pray that you will, through the Holy Spirit, give us understanding of your word. We pray that your grace will open our eyes and ears and hearts while studying your word so that we can see all the wonders you reveal. We are thankful for the living relationship we have with you because of the life-giving power of your word that revives our souls. We are grateful that your word lifts us up in times of joy and comforts us in times of despair. We thank you for the hope and the renewal of life found in the scriptures that encourage us to continue in prayer in good times and in difficult times. We believe your testimonies and rely on your promises. We pray for the guidance of the Holy Spirit for ourselves and also for the citizens of the world, particularly the United States at this time. We also pray for the thousands worldwide who study the Bible and are guided by the Holy Spirit to good thoughts that produce good works. We ask you to protect those whose lives are in jeopardy because they study the Bible in countries where that is not allowed. In particular, today we pray for Patricia, Michael, Linda, Audrey, and the DeShetler family, Brad, Camilla, Alistair, the Watkins family, and Caitlin. We pray that your word will bring them comfort and bring them close to you. May their hearts and our hearts be filled with your mercy, grace, and peace. May we make your word the standard of our faith and the law of our practice. May we take your word to the world. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
times in the biblical text. More times than hope, love, and faith put together. Sometimes it's inviting us to give of ourselves. Many times it's used in a sense of giving our resources. I'm sure Simon, with the Greek that he's understanding, could give us lots of different interpretations of the word give in Greek. I await that, Simon. However, we are people who are called to give in many ways, and this morning, as is our custom, we now bring our offerings, and so let them be received.
Thank you. Friends, as we prepare to hear God's word, let us pray. May the good Lord shine a light on you, warm as the evening sun. May the good Lord shine a light on you, make every song you sing your favorite tune. Amen. Now this morning's reading is going to be a little different. It's from Psalm 119, the longest psalm in the Psalter with its 176 verses. I'll be reading select verses this morning, 10 in total. And as I do so, I invite you to pause on each verse, allowing God's Spirit to speak to you through our Holy Scripture. Happy are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are you, O Lord, teach me your statutes. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. Open my eyes so that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. My soul melts away for sorrow. Strengthen me according to your word. This is my comfort in my distress, that your promise gives me life. Your statutes have been my songs wherever I make my home. I will never forget your precepts, for by them you have given me life. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to
God. Our Lord is an ambassador.
Several years ago, Dylan, Katie, and I attended a different church. I think I always refer to that other church anonymously so we can feel better about ourselves. This other church invited us to partake in a program. And it was a four-week program where you could learn more about their church. And we thought, well, you know, we've been here for a few years now, we might as well do the course. What we didn't realize, and what no one told us, is that by the end of week four, you were officially a member of that church, whether you wanted it or not. And part of this ceremony invited walking across the stage on a Sunday morning and receiving a Bible with your name in it. And so we were a little shocked. We said, we just want to find out more about the church. We're millennials. We don't care about membership. And they said, well, you know, that's not a problem. We would still like to present you with a Bible. So we emailed them back, and I said, well, here's the problem. There are countries in the world where people are persecuted for just reading scripture. There are countries where it's illegal to have a Bible in your possession. These are all my Bibles. Do I need another one? So I said to them, I have 13 Bibles at home. I feel, you know, they say the Bible is the best-selling book of all time. It's probably because ministers have 50 of them. Well, I asked them if it would be possible, I'm going to hide the name of the church. I asked them if it would be possible to just walk across the stage, shake someone's hand, and just not get a Bible. And they said, no, that's not possible. You have to get a Bible. And I said, okay, well, could you at least not put my name in it so that I can give it to someone else who doesn't have a Bible? I would feel a lot better about that. They said, sure, that's a fine compromise. So on the day of our official membership, we walked across the stage, and I was handed a Bible in a nice little box, and I was like, oh, okay, great, it's brand new. And I open it, and on the front page it says, Simon LeSieur's Bible. Yeah, I was going to throw it on the ground, but one thing, so I spent some time in India, and one of the things that I really loved about the brothers and sisters of the faith in India is that they never, ever let their scriptures touch the ground. You know, here I am at home, I've got them kind of all over the place, and I really, really came to admire their reverence for, I think, a book that we don't always understand here. And so we'll be talking about this morning, looking a little bit more in depth at scripture. This to me is my most precious one. And I think even more so today. This was a Bible that my grandmother gave me. Many of you know my story, and when I was a teenager, one of those rebellious, I had blue hair, and I was dressed always in black, and I had the chains, and anyway, all of that stuff. And I lived with my grandmother for the summer. And the only book that she had in her house that wasn't in Dutch was this book. And I thought, well, I got nothing else to do and nothing to lose, and so... And I err towards the A type, and so I... decided a good challenge is, I'm going to read this from cover to cover. And it was reading this book that changed my life. And when my Oma a year later said to me, would you like to keep it? I said, absolutely. Now, I don't want to go on and on and on and on about my Oma, but as Philip mentioned, she passed away on Friday. I just want to share with you the kind of woman that she was. Probably 3 or 4 years ago, she had a stroke, and because of her stroke, she lost most of her eyesight. I was talking with her just a few months ago, and she said, you know, Simon, I was pretty silly. When I lost my eyesight, I think I went through a little bit of a depression. But I look back now, and I was being silly. All I lost was my eyesight. I don't need my eyesight to pray. That was the kind of woman that she was. Let's pray. God, you are good. And you are here. Always. God, as we dig deep into your scriptures today, may you speak to us. May you challenge us. May you encourage us. We pray all of this in Jesus' awesome, holy name. Amen. So I've been waiting since September to be able to say this. So this says, Halagos to Theou. Can you all say that with me? We'll do this. I know I hate that when people do that, but let's say this together. Halagos to Theou. So I'm taking Greek this semester for fun, and it's been really great. And this means the word of God. And I was really proud that I could bring something that I learned into this space. So there we go. The word of God, this is what we'll be talking. Now, there's always a whole bunch of different understandings of what is scripture. Is the Bible itself the word of God? And I think I tend to side with Karl Barth, who once said that the Bible contains the word of God as expressed through the words of its human authors. There is, in this book, the word of God that is alive and that transforms. So this morning I want to do two things. The first thing I want to do is look with you through the Christian story. We're surrounded by so many narratives in this world, and it's helpful to at very least understand the Christian story. Because understanding where we've come from and understanding where all of this is going hopefully will give us a glimpse or a little bit of a smile as we make our way through things like the American election. We know there's hope. And so I want to start by looking at our story. And then I want to briefly give us a few different ways that we can engage as 21st century followers of Christ, that we can engage with this book in ways that are that I think are a little more tangible. So if you brought a Bible with you this morning, or you can grab one in the pews, I'll invite you to follow along with me as we go through these pages. I know we don't have Bibles for everyone. You'll be okay. You'll be okay if you don't have one. If you do have one, though, please turn with me to the very beginning. Now, I'm borrowing this morning from some professors that I had in my undergrad, Craig Bartholomew and Mike Goheen, who presented the story as the drama of Scripture. So it's the kind of the six acts of the Christian story. And so we start with Act 1. Act 1 is always the act that gives us the background, right? That gives us an understanding of where we come from. So we'll start by looking at Genesis 1, verses 1 to 3, which in the black pew Bibles is on page 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was formless, was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. So I understand Genesis, the creation story, is a controversial narrative. When I started my undergrad, the very first day I arrived, and two of my roommates were sitting on the front porch arguing evolution versus creation. And I was like, oh, I don't, I'm gonna stay away from that. What's helpful for us to know? And this would be my understanding, is that the Genesis narrative is an intuitive poem about our origins. There's a theologian named A.J. Swoboda. He points out, he's looked at all the different creation narratives out there, and he points out two really interesting things. The first one is that both man and woman are created good. That's unique to our story, that man and woman are created in God's image. The other piece that Swoboda points out is that this is the only narrative in which human beings are called to rest, are commanded to rest. In a lot of the other narratives, humanity serves to, is our humanity is enslaved to the gods. In the Genesis story, we're called to rest. Now, we often talk about how day seven is God's day of rest. But if you look at it, Adam and Eve's very first day is a day of rest. And I love, this is what Swoboda says. And he says, this is the essence of the gospel. The gospel doesn't say, work really hard on yourself until you're good enough to be loved. The gospel says, you are loved. Rest in that truth. And together, we will work towards redemption. And so that's Act 1, where we come from. If you'll turn with me, just turn the page right over. Act 1's really short. And we're going to turn to Act 2, the fall, Genesis 3, verses 6 to 8. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. And the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. This narrative doesn't give all the details. How did evil come into creation? How can the snake talk? But I think what this question answers is the age-old question of what happened. Why is the world the way it is? In Act 2, often referred to as the fall, we're shown where our path and God's path go separate ways. Adam and Eve choose autonomy over relationship. And verse 8 to me is particularly poignant, that they hide from the presence of God. That prior to this, God would walk the garden with humanity. And through this event, they choose their way. And this is what the rest of these pages is about. If you turn with me now to Act 3, Israel is chosen. So we have a problem, right? Adam and Eve choose their own way. And from that moment on, God is trying to re-enter into relationship with the creation. And so in Genesis 12, verses 1 to 3, we have Act 3. Israel is chosen. Now the Lord said to Abraham, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you. I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." And so here we have the establishment of God's covenant with Israel. What's interesting here, and we see this in Act 2, what changes, Adam and Eve don't lose their humanity. They're still created in God's image. What changes is how they are human. And so what we see here in chapter 12 is God bridging that gap, re-inviting us to discover the fullness of what it means to be human. And this story unfolds throughout the rest of the Old Testament, or the Jewish scriptures. All of this is filled with prophecy, what they call the wisdom literature, poetry, and a historical narrative. And so that's Act 3. Is a story of God continuously trying to build that bridge back to humanity. And we as human beings constantly choosing our own way. Now if you'll flip to me to page, now it's kind of hard because there's no page number, page 781. So in your pew Bibles it looks like this. So what you have on page 779 is the end of Malachi, and what you have on page 782 is the Gospel of Matthew. Now what they refer to these two semi-blank pages is the intertestamental period, which is 400 years between the end of Malachi and the beginning of Matthew. So that's just a little thing for you to show off at the Westerly this evening. Did you know about the intertestamental period? So that's our interlude. Now if you'll turn with me to Mark 1. Act 4 is Mark 1 verses 14 to 15 is a verse that characterizes this act, and it's Jesus in the kingdom of God. And so what we see throughout the story, we've seen so far, we have a creation, we've got the fall, and then we have this period where God is continuously trying to enter back into covenant with God's people. And then in the New Testament, we have the new covenant. And verse 14 says, "Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news.'" And so what we have in Act 4 is Jesus proclaiming the arrival of the kingdom. What God's people for thousands of years were struggling through, Jesus says, this kingdom is now here. Now before we shift to Act 5, I'm going to cheat a little bit and give you a spoiler alert, which is Act 6. So turn with me to the book of Revelation. Now please, don't ever start reading scripture by reading Revelation. It's really weird. Though, in all fairness, there's a university student, Ben Morley-Sankler, who is our office manager's son, who loves these concepts of light and dark and all of, you know, dragons and all these things. And so when he asked me one day, Simon, where could I start reading scripture? I said, oh my goodness, you would love Revelation. And he came back 3 days later and was like, what now? You don't have any questions? So Revelation 21, verse 1 to 5. Now, this is the final act. This is Act 6. This is where it's all headed. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples. And God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. My favorite passage in all of Scripture is from Revelation 22. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, and through the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is the tree of life, with its 12 kinds of fruits, producing its fruit each month, and the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. Now, do you notice anything? We start with a tree. We end with a tree. We start with God walking alongside Adam and Eve. And we end Revelation 21. See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. So we start with God walking with us in the garden, and we end with God once again walking with us in the garden. That's the hope. But we have Act 5. And so turn with me to Acts 2, verse 37. Now we have this arc, right? We have Jesus proclaiming the kingdom is here. And we have Act 6, where the kingdom, the new creation, is here. And so you might want to go, how do we get there? And Act 5 is all about the mission of the church. The mission that you and I are called into. The important work of not simply coming on a Sunday morning, but living these realities. Living in such a way that we can get to Act 6. So verse 37, this is the beginning of the church. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him. And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, They broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. And so this is the Christian story. Now, the beautiful part of all of this is you can choose what story you want to be a part of. But as followers of Christ, the mission of the church is to help us get from Act 4 to Act 6, to partner with God in creation, to live in such a way that our actions and our words make this world a little bit more like the world that Jesus envisioned. And so, I want to end with this, and this is the second part. I want to briefly give you three different ways that you can engage with this book. I'm calling it the, from A to Zen. And the first one is for you A-types out there who like a good challenge. Julie's like, no. For you A-types out there who love a good challenge, read it from cover to cover. It changed my life. I think reading through Chronicles, which is like all the genealogies, probably changed my life more than anything. It showed me I was patient. Read it from cover to cover. If that seems a little intimidating, start with the Gospels. The Gospel of Mark is often said to be the best place to start. So that's your first entry point, is to simply read it. A second part would be to join one of a Bible study, whether we have it here or whether it's with a different community. But this book isn't meant to be read on your own. It's been written in a way that begs involvement in a community. So read it in community. Read it with other people. When I was younger, I used to just randomly go and then read that as my verse for the day. But here's the problem, actually. This is a great example where I just put my finger, says that there is no God. I'm going to walk with that the rest of this day. But so context is important, because that sentence actually says, fools say in their hearts, there is no God. When you encounter difficult passages, that's where community comes in. And so read this on your own, at your own peril. And then the last entry point is for more of you Zen types. It's an old method that goes back to the early church called Lectio Divina. And it's very simple. And I'll give you a brief example. So say we take that very first passage that I read from Genesis 1. What you do is you choose a passage of scripture, and you read it the first time. And as you read it the first time, you listen for words that jump out to you. One of my earlier mentors described to me that the Holy Spirit was a little bit like a highlighter. And so as you would read, certain words would jump off the page at you. And so you do a first reading, paying attention to what jumps off the page. So let me just read these first three verses, and I'll invite you to listen carefully for a word or an expression that jumps out. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. So that's what you do on your first reading, is you listen for words that stand out. And you do a second reading of it, asking yourself, why might this word stand out to me today and whatever's going on in my life? And so I'll read it a second time, and I'll invite you to ask yourself this question. Whatever word it was that stood out to you on your first reading, now ask yourself, why would this word stand out? In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. So first reading, what stands out? Second reading, why would this stand out? Third reading, what might God be trying to say to me through this word? Let's read this a third time. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And then one final reading. On this last reading, the question is, so what? How will I live my life differently, knowing God's invitation through this text? And so I'll read it one last time, and I invite you to reflect on this word or expression that stood out to you, and to ask yourself, what am I being invited to do today or this week? How am I being invited to live differently or more deeply in this world? In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Now, I started this morning by saying, by quoting Karl Barth, who talks about this book containing the Word of God as expressed through the words of its human authors. And this method that I just shared with you, to me, has been personally, I think, one of the most profound ways of letting God's living Word come through what can be sometimes difficult or dry passages. And so I invite you, when you go home, when you make a practice of whatever ritual it is that you have in your life, to take time to open this book and to engage with it in whatever way brings life to you, so that you and I can live all the days of our life trying to bridge the gap from Act 4 to Act 6. Amen.
Thank you.
What word stands out to me? Why might this stand out to me? What might God be saying to me through this word? And how will I live differently? And so may you go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.